A House lawmaker says the Philippine National Police should pursue institutional changes in training and evaluating police officers after Nuesca's fatal shooting of his neighbors in Tarlac. Joining us now on the program is Muntinlupa Representative Ruffy Biazon for more on this. Congressman Biazon is a member of the House Committee on Public Order and Safety. Good morning, Congressman, and thank you for joining us this morning, sir.
Yes, good morning, Christian, and to your viewers. Good morning.
Okay, first, let's talk about this this opposite perspectives. On one hand, critics of the Philippine National Police are saying that the Philippine National Police as an organization has been tainted, and this problem is somehow reflective of a systemic or even structural problem within the organization. But on the other hand, the PNP is saying this is an isolated case. What do you think?
Well, I wouldn't agree that they would immediately dismiss it as an isolated case. But they should view this as a symptom of what could be ailing the institution. It is really not the first time that a policeman has crossed the boundary of discipline and duty and inflicted harm on civilians. So they must look into their organization and find out why these individuals, we're stressing individuals, are doing this. Because in this particular case, you can see that it was a breach of discipline. It was a breach of police operational procedures. So there's something wrong with how the institution handles its people, which causes individuals to do this.
Okay, of course, you yourself mentioned that this is not the first time that something of this sort has happened. What would you like to see coming out of this entire episode, gruesome as it is, in terms of perhaps institutional reform or changes?
Yes, first, we would want to see for the PNP, the DILG, for government to review the processes in recruitment, in training, in managing their personnel. I believe that there should be a constant evaluation of policemen's mental fitness for duty, because the job of policemen is tough. It's violent. It's it may go across public opinion, and it would cause stress to them. So there is such a thing as post-traumatic stress syndrome, and they should be constantly looking out for it. And then they should look into their processes where policemen commit violations. If we compare them to the military, if a soldier commits an offense, he could immediately be discharged from the service, even pending a case, a trial. Why can't we do it with the policemen? Because they are imbibed with authority. They're given firepower to enforce the law. So it's really, I think it's really incumbent upon us to really make sure that those who are given that power and authority are kept in check. And if we can do it with the soldiers, we should also be doing it with the PNP. Because as we can see, this particular police officer had previous offenses, although it was said that he was dismissed. Mm. But there seems to be a pattern, particularly with regard to drugs, the refusal to take a drug exam and the involvement in a drug case.
So definitely there was a problem within the system, because despite all those cases or complaints filed against him, he was able to go scot-free. Of course, on at least two occasions, I think he was actually suspended. But in this case, it led to this, the brutal killing of the mother and the son. But your proposal to somehow make it somehow closer to the way the military disciplines its men, you would like to see that within the Philippine National Police, but wouldn't that require legislation?
Yes, in fact, we are doing some legislation on this. There is an ongoing hearing on a bill to strengthen the Internal Affairs Service of the PNP. But as we can see, I think we should even take a step further and look into how the AFP does it. Because I've been in touch with many military personnel, and that's a common thing that they say, that one difference between the AFP and the PNP is that in the AFP, when you have an offense, you immediately suffer the consequence. You may undergo trial because under the Constitution, everybody is entitled to a trial and convicted in a court of law. But they lose their job, and it becomes difficult for them to go back to the service. In the PNP, there's a process that allows them to apply again or make an appeal. But it's the institution's choice whether to accept somebody who's had previous violations. So these are systems that are different between the two institutions. So we would like to see it become uniform.
But of course, there's such a thing as a due process also. In fact, that was mentioned by PNP Chief Debold Sinas to explain why the previous cases did not prosper against Staff Sergeant Jonella Nuesca. So in this case, do you think the Philippine National Police, as an institution, has a system that provides too much due process, which can be exploited, or is actually exploited?
Well, the due process is still there. The offending person is still subject to trial to be determined if he's guilty or not. But as I said, there has never been a question about how the military does it. And the similarity between the two is that you give them authority and you give them firearms, they give them weapons. So there's a special consideration, I think, for this particular set of persons. There's a huge responsibility that they have, even most especially with the PNP, because not only are they given the task to enforce the law, they are given authority over civilians, over people. It's a big responsibility.
Don't you think that explains why there's such a big difference in terms of the quickness or the speed with which the institutions could actually discipline their own men? For instance, we know that the military by nature has a different focus compared to the focus of the Philippine National Police, which deals largely or mostly with civilians. And both, of course, are expected to be professional.
Yes, the AFP is very focused. They go against those who take up arms against government and society. In the case of the PNP, they have authority over all of us. So it's a huge responsibility, which really entails a more strict adherence to discipline. And as we can see, in many times in the past, they have crossed over it. So it's, for me, it's not appropriate for the institution to just say that it's an isolated case, because there is a history of it happening. We should learn from this already, a lesson that should have been learned a long time ago.
Okay, let's talk about the available mechanisms within the Philippine National Police. We know that there is the National Police Commission. We know that there is the Internal Affairs Service, or IAS. We also have the PLEB, the People's Law Enforcement Board. And of course, the chiefs of police, or even the Philippine National Police himself, can actually discipline his own men. So what more can we ask for if you have all these available remedies to address issues like this? I mean, what particular changes would you like to see in terms of speed, for instance?
Well, I think, as I pointed out, the one in the AFP system, wherein the automatic discharge based on an offense, we have many mechanisms in the AFP, in the PNP, but the immediate action that needs to be taken is not there. In fact, it adds to the whole bureaucracy and red tape of taking them into account. I believe we could adopt that system wherein with one offense, you're taken out of the job, because the job entails a huge responsibility. So I think that's one key element that's missing there, because that's what I hear from the personnel themselves, especially the military. They have some gripes about it, because they know that an offense immediately warrants a discharge. You lose your job. You lose your authority.
Their benefits, of course.
Yes. Well, that comes, well, we don't have separation or retirement, because you're dishonorably discharged.
Yeah. But they agree with the position that somehow the Philippine National Police, or at least many of its men, have become even more emboldened, have become even more trigger-happy under this current atmosphere that we have now. Because largely, you have pronouncements coming from the president himself, giving them, quote-unquote, those orders, and somehow making them more, even more trigger-happy.
Well, you know, there is a tendency really to abuse. And if they misread what the president says, you can see it happening. In fact, the more reason you can say that it's not an isolated case, because in the aftermath of the shooting, there have been some police officers who came out, the police chief in Catanduanes. It warranted the removal from his post because he came out with an opinion which kind of supported or justified the actions taken by Sergeant Huesca. And there's the two more I saw on social media circulating. So that should be a cause for alarm for the leaders. But somehow the way of thinking of our police officers is veering away from the mantra of to serve and protect civilians.
Yeah, precisely. That was quite alarming because there were a couple of other police officers who even justified what Staff Sergeant Huesca did, which was obviously wrong, which was brutal, di ba? Cold-blooded murder, if you look at it, if you saw the video. But again, my point is, how much of this do you think is affected, this kind of mentality, this so-called utak pulbura culture within the Philippine National Police? How much of this is affected or influenced by the president himself? Because you said it's also a matter of misreading what the president has been saying. But what is there to misread if, in fact, there are certain things that are quite clear, or even the contradictions within certain statements, you could see that there's that that attitude, that seeming marching order to disregard human rights?
Well, the president's statement is directed in relation to the drug war. So you can, to me, the president has the passion for his drug war. But unfortunately, you have more than 100,000 policemen. I don't remember the exact number, but I'm sure there are those who would take that order to the extreme. And obviously, this is a case because I don't believe that Sergeant Huesca just did it out of yung sinasabing nandilim ang paningin. As I was observing the video, parang cool and collected, no? And he actually, my reading is that he just pulled the trigger out of spite for the lady answering back to his daughter, which in the first place was an irresponsible thing to do. You don't bring your daughter to shoot a video on if he was going to act on to respond to a supposed disturbance. And then eventually, in front of the child, pull out your gun and shoot someone else. You know, he exposed his own daughter to this. And the outrageous thing there is that the person he shot was restraining the person he was supposed to accost. There was no threat to him. So it's really something that should wake us all up, that there is something wrong with the system.
And that's why this should not be regarded as simply as an isolated case, because there are other policemen like him who could easily pull the trigger. And then I think another important issue that needs to be focused on here is, how do you somehow weed out that culture, even subculture of utak pulbura? I mean, I use that term because this is the term being used within the Philippine National Police. How do you weed that out? I mean, how do you do that in terms of training? Because we see that, for example, in communities, diba? Some police officers feel very emboldened, very powerful, because they have been given a firearm by the state, by the government. And somehow, the sense of responsibility is not commensurate with the immense power that they're actually wielding. That's why siga-siga sila sa community. That's why you have people like Huesca. I mean, how do you weed out this kind of culture within the Philippine National Police?
Well, we go to training first. You pointed out about training. I just feel that there's blurred line between the way we train our policemen and our soldiers. You know, they have two entirely different doctrines, supposedly. Soldiers are trained to kill without hesitation because that's what the job entails, to kill the enemy and reach the objective. But policemen are supposed to be trained to act with restraint, using their power and authority with restraint. But we see our Philippine National Police being trained in a similar fashion with the military. Take, for example, the Philippine National Police. We practically patterned it after the PNA from the kind of training and indoctrination to the uniforms that they wear. So it starts there. If we look into how we train our personnel, we don't train them similarly with the military. I think that's a starting point, because it all starts from there. How we train them, and then a continuous monitoring of our personnel. Like, for I know that in the United States, whenever a police officer is involved in a shooting, they immediately undergo some sort of evaluation, psychological or mental evaluation, to see the effects of that kind of experience. And then that's a regular and continuing thing. So I think that's one of the things that we can do.
Finally, Congressman Biazon, how about the culture of impunity? How much of it has to do with cases like this? I mean, for instance, if you have a very professional organization, well-trained police officers, I don't think it would be easy for such a policeman or policewoman to pull the trigger unless it is really necessary and in the line of duty. Because you know that if you do that, you would be held accountable. In this case, definitely he is expected to be held accountable, but largely because there was a video. He was caught on video. But how about the others who have gone away scot-free after doing perhaps even more brutal crimes against helpless citizens or civilians?
Well, this is one thing that the institution really has to look into itself. First is holding those persons accountable. If the rest, if one bad egg gets away with it or does not suffer a consequence, the entire organization is witness to that. And it would affect how individual members think and have belief in the system of the institution. So we really have to look into those processes where the Philippine National Police is holding accountable their members. There's a lot of things really that we need to do, but it's one thing that we could start with coming out of this incident.
Okay, Congressman Ruffy Biazon, thank you very much for joining us, and Merry Christmas in advance.
Thank you so much, and Merry Christmas to you.